such fear of missing out. I can't even tell you. What am I missing? Tell me everything.
So what you're missing is the most unorganized version of how to get to Radio Row right now. It is insane how hard it is to get in this damn place. Do you literally have to go and check in and then immediately...
I'm holding it now. Is this like Rodney Harrison at the game when he's got somebody holding this umbrella over his head? Like, this is very precious of you to have Hamilton.
Yeah, I didn't know because now I got the mic taken away.
Okay, so the setup.
Okay, so what kind of show are you running out here, Kay?
One where I'm not even freaking there.
I know. Where are you at right now?
I'm in New York City. I'm on a hotel floor, which is. I'm just getting used to the germs for Vegas. It's fine. I'm just making sense of it all, just building up my immunity. I'm going to be in Vegas later tonight, but I need to know. Like, I was talking to Sandra Douglas Morgan, the president of the Raiders, and she's like from Vegas, a local. And I'm a little overwhelmed with how much is going on. Like, it's kind of overstimulating.
Yeah, it is. What is going on here is. There's probably not a better place. The only place that would probably rival here is Nashville, Tennessee, as far as throwing a Super Bowl and all that, which we'll get 2027, 2028. It is an absolute zoo down here. Just getting in this damn building is a process. It is, but it's unbelievable. Like, the people walking through here, the energy, media day was yesterday with all the players. Got to get George Kittle and Christian McCaffrey. It's awesome, man. You are missing out, and I hate that I'm basically throwing a dagger in you right now and telling you, hey, you are missing out a whole bunch, but you'll be here tonight, and it's going to be amazing.
I want to see you, and I want to see Will Compton. I want to see Javi. I've been practicing push-ups. It's a whole thing. But you were at media night last night. I want to get into it because you got some amazing answers to some great questions. Let's take a look. Hopefully.
Are we taking a look?
I thought we had a thought, don't we? Do we have a thought of them both?
Travis! Yes, when you were going to do New Heights podcast, were there any player podcasts that you were getting inspiration from?
1,000%. Most of them with the boys, baby.
Yeah, I just want to make sure. Thank you very much.
Check it out. Make sure you check it out and hit the follow button, baby.
Yeah. All right, Travis, we'll see you later, buddy. Thank you. We'll see you later. Done. Let's go home.
How was it?
Dude, it was awesome. Travis, I've known Travis for, I don't know, 6-7 years now. He's a great dude, but his success that he's had, obviously, on and off the field, him and Jason, and obviously with the Taylor Swift situation, he's just done such a graceful job of entering this true A-list celebrity situation. For him to have fun with it and enjoy the moment, and it just seems like a guy that the moment's never too big for him. He's shown that on the football field, but also when life outside of football, you know, becomes bigger and more in the public eye, he just seems like he's taking it and being his same self. And I'm a big fan of Travis, man. We had a good time. George Kittle was out there too, and you know, we were actually trying to get everybody's attention. It is a lawless world in the media world when you're trying to get somebody's attention to ask a question. And there were little ladies, we're talking about 5'2", that were absolutely bulldozing me the whole time. And so we started screaming at George, yeah, you. We're screaming at George, and some lady in the back said, sir, we're not gonna yell. And George's like, no, they can yell. And it's so cool to establish these relationships with these guys and then uniquely be in the position to ask them questions from a media standpoint and just having that rapport that we do. It was a really great time.
And the other unique part is that you're asking questions and trying to do your job, but you're also being asked questions by global media because they're seeing, oh my gosh, there's Taylor Lewan. I want to ask. So you're doing media. You're giving interviews, I saw. Then you're asking questions. And it is a harrowing experience. You have a height advantage. You were a player. I remember my first Super Bowl was Alex Smith, Colin Kaepernick, Jacoby Jones. We were in New Orleans, and I was elbowing people. I was wearing, like, I dressed myself up like a peacock in bright colors to try to, like, separate myself. Like, you got, like, the Chiquita Banana ladies walking around. You've got Guillermo handing out crazy shit to people. It is absolutely a scene. You guys crushed it for Busting with the Boys, and I can't wait to see some more of that content. And I loved seeing George Kittle talk about the Beer Olympics and all that. It's amazing. But speaking of beer, I got to get your take on you-know-who, Kyle Shanahan, a.k.a. Boozy Susie. Take a look.
I didn't hear Jed say that because it wasn't the smartest moment I've ever had. I mean, when owner comes in after training camp practices and is like, hey, how's the quarterback? And what he means is the starter or the second. And you in irritation go, I don't know, but our third guy's the best. Like, that's not what he wants to hear. So that's why he remembers it very strong. But that was just more Brock was so good right away with every rep he got. He was always the same. And he only got a couple of them. So it was easy for me to say. Because in his few reps, he was the best.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that. Because Kyle, there's so much ego that goes into this sport. You know that. So many higher ups. There was a report yesterday about Mike Vrabel being too big to have a head coaching job. Like, there's so much ego involved. And when you look at head coaches talking to GMs, talking to owners, and they have to sit there and say, hey, I know you have a first round pick that you took number 5 overall. I know you traded for this guy and all these different things, but the guy you picked last in the draft is the best guy. It takes a lot of stones to go and tell an owner that when he's spending tens of millions of dollars on other guys to have that job. So shout out to Kyle, man. That's a big move, and knowing doing what's best for the team regardless of where the paycheck's being located.
You talked to him. Was he drunk?
When I talked to Kyle?
Did you talk to Kyle yesterday? Everyone's saying he was like drunk on Twitter, and everyone's like, hey, I don't want to see my coach loose like this. Was he, what did you do? Did you think he was a little buzzed or no?
No, I wouldn't say though. And what's wrong with the guys having a couple of cold pops right before a stressful media day too? He can do whatever he wants, man. If he wins a Super Bowl, it's like, let's just drink more then, boys, right? I did have one question for him, and it's a very unique parallel, because the last time a head coach with the last name Shanahan won a Super Bowl, he had a McCaffrey on his team. And I didn't know if that was makes him more nervous, more anxious, mm-hmm. or if it was more exciting knowing that his odds are a little bit better having a McCaffrey on his team. So if the guy wants to have a couple of pops, get after a little bit, have a little bit of fun, I'm a fan of it.
How many, what did you call it, pops? How many pops are you going to have? Over under, I don't even know. You set the over under for this week.
No, the over under for this week is probably 2, because I have gotten to the point being having 2 daughters, 6 and 3, and drinking for me is like, it was fun when I was in my early 20s, and you get after it in a lot of ways. And I'm sure there's a lot of people in Nashville, Tennessee that can tell some horrendous, horrific stories about me being blackout drunk on Demumbian Street. But now it's, I pick and choose my battles. So we have Beer Olympics every year. Like my wife and I, we go to Cabo every year, and I'll know those 3-4 days, your boy's gonna be in a blender. I'm gonna be blurry eyed the entire time. Days like, weeks like this week, when it seems like Super Bowl, Vegas, it's time to get after it. This is where you kind of take advantage of the situation. I get to go, clarity of mind, come sit down with you on this show, even though you're not here right now. I'm able to come on your show and have a good time and feel good about doing it too. So the drinking for me has really shut down quite a bit, but I pick and choose my battles.
I love this for you, because you never know when you're going to be at an event and the camera's going to come to you, and you have to like bake in those impromptu, unscheduled times where you're going to have to chug a couple beers. You're going to have to shotgun one because you're at an event and the camera comes your way. So I like this disciplined, rigorous routine that you have here. I thought that I was drunk when I saw this image. And I know you're not like sponsoring this per se, or maybe you are. I don't know. What the hell am I looking at here? What in fact is this?
That is a company called Shipt, and they, for those of you who need anything for the big game, you can get delivered by Shipt, dude, within the day for all your needs. Talking about chips, salsas, the whole kit and caboodle when you're throwing your big game party. I don't think you can say Super Bowl. Such a weird term around that, or some copyright. But yeah, we were at the Barstool Content House, and they brought that beautiful piece of machinery. That thing gets up to 55 miles an hour, Kay. The guy was ripping us up and down this neighborhood in a giant shopping cart. It was a very cool experience, to say the least.
I love that. So let's dig into the Super Bowl, because you're not in a shopping cart. You're on Radio Row. You're doing the whole thing, busting with the boys. It's all happening. Will Compton's there. When we dig into the actual nitty-gritty of the Super Bowl, one of the biggest matchups everyone's talking about is, of course, the Niners pass rush up against that Chiefs offensive line. And when asked about their O-line, Nick Bosa said they hold a lot. Now, as a former O-lineman, what do you think of Bosa calling out the tackles right before the Super Bowl?
Yeah, that's a thing to me. If like Nick Bosa came out and they were like, hey, where are the issues going to be with the offensive line? And he said, there's not going to be any issues. That's when you take the pin tack, you put it on the bulletin board, and you say, boys, this is what we got to do. We got to shut Nick Bosa up. Good luck with that. When it comes to holding, it's like, it must be a Bosa thing, because obviously guys complain about holding all the time, and I did my fair share of it legally and illegally in the game. But I remember playing Joey Bosa a couple times, and it was always like, you always hold, as if that's some sort of an insult. It's like, brother, I got my hands on you. I got these mitts on you, and you're not going anywhere. That's a big W for me. So, but But the Chiefs offensive line, they've been called over and over and over again. And that's where you have to, this week, every penalty, every single play counts in trying to host that Lombardi trophy. So when you're going to get those hands, and you are going to hold inevitably what you do as an offensive lineman, what you need to do is get those hands inside and take them out of the shoulder pads. For me, if I'm on the Chiefs and Nick Bosa says that, that's not a bulletin board thing. That's more just like, you know, you look at statistically how much have we been flagged. And then if it's a lot, it's like, well, he's not wrong. He's absolutely not wrong in that situation.
I'm looking at FanDuel Sportsbook right now. I'm looking at the prop for total sacks by the Niners defense. And it's set at 2.5 over under.
Over. I think over. I think Nick's going to have two of them himself. I think Chase Young will get himself one, and they'll get pressure up the middle for sure. Chase Young, man, it was we had a live stream after the NFC Championship game, and I had a couple of choice words for Chase. When they were down, I saw him lazy on a couple of plays, and that's a horrible thing to say about a player, but he was the energy wasn't there. There was a touchdown run where he was chasing down the line of scrimmage as he should have been, but he was jogging, and he had the opportunity to make a play and save a touchdown, and it was against Gibbs. And it didn't make it happen. Those type of things cannot happen. This has to be a full effort, empty the gas tank type of situation. And I think Chase is going to rise to that occasion when it comes to rushing the quarterback.
Our time of possession is so important. Everything, like the conditioning, it's so late playing all of these games. And then this week is such a, like, we're tired and exhausted. Like, they are too. And so managing who's in there, the rotation, all of it's also insane. So over the last 5 seasons, the Niners have made the playoffs 4 times. They've won 2 NFC championships. First trip back to the Super Bowl, of course, since that 2019 season when they lost to the Chiefs in Miami. What do you think the single most important thing the Niners need to focus on to make sure that they win this time around?
The single most important thing is to utilize Christian McCaffrey. I think you put Brock Purdy in a position to make opportunistic throws, but you put the workload on Christian McCaffrey. You have so many aliens on the outside. You have George Kittle playing that Y, who's also a great blocker. But I would give Christian McCaffrey the ball 30 times a game. I would take care of that time of possession and keep the Chiefs off the field. I know their points per game hasn't been as high as they have been in years past, but every time Patrick Mahomes has the ball in his hand, that's when you're holding your breath as a 49ers fan. So it is very critical that you handle the line of scrimmage, you make sure that Christian McCaffrey gets his touches, and you give him a couple of lanes and keep those chains moving and get yourself in those third and manageable situations and control the game that way. This doesn't have to be a sexy game. This game needs to be knocked down, drag him out from a 49er standpoint, and get to the end of the fourth quarter with a W.
And I saw your deep dive of 13 and Taylor. I thought it was incredibly well done, but you picked the Niners.
Am I taking the Niners, are you asking?
I said, I saw your whole Taylor Swift breakdown of the ones and the threes and the 13s and the subtracting from 187s, all of that. But you ended up, you're picking the Niners, yeah?
Yeah, my heart, it says the Niners, but my brain, like we talked about, is saying the Chiefs. Like, it's such a, right. It's so incredible. I've been on multiple shows and I've flip-flopped so many times. But on That's this show, I will say I am taking the 49ers.
I say it every, I'll be like, Niners, Chiefs. Niners, Chiefs. I just want a good game. That's sort of my rap sheet, and everybody.
And that's the best part about this.
Right. Nobody cares.
Yeah, it's like the fact that we're at the Super Bowl and we're not saying like everybody's taking this team and no one's taking this other team. It truly is like this might be one of the greatest Super Bowls of all time that we get to sit here and like truly be divided 50-50 down the middle. Who's taking what? Like that is what we're all fired up about.
Yeah, it's funny you say 50-50, but would I be surprised? Like the Chiefs. The Chiefs have the momentum, and the Niners, I don't know if they do. So that's what will be. That's to me, it's an easier roll off the tongue to say the Chiefs will win than the Niners for some reason right now. But maybe it'll change.
The 49ers just haven't put 4 quarters of football together. Yeah. But the fact that they finished on such a high note against the Lions, being down that much at half and coming back, I mean, you can look at the Lions and say, like, yeah, like Dan Campbell should have kicked that field goal. And there's a lot of statistics. I think it was like 82% on 4th-and-3 for the Lions. And their kicker with that depth was at like, I think, like 60%. So statistically, you want to go for it. But if I'm Dan Campbell and you're in that type of situation, that's a dagger by the 3. So it's incredible the momentum they're going into with these 2 weeks to prepare.
What happened with Vrabel? You mentioned it. I read the quote and I thought it was a joke. And then, but it's,
yeah,
do it right about it being him not getting a job with a very large human. It's intimidating to people in the organization. Why didn't he land a coaching job?
I don't know why he didn't. So let's go back to that report. I think ML Football reported that on X. And I actually had the opportunity to see Diana Rossini yesterday, who was, you know, I saw her, gave her a big hug. I love Diana. And she goes, I kind of talked about the Vrabel thing, and she just gets tight about it. She's like, that's not what I said. They're reporting it like it's a report. But really, someone just said that to her, that he's an intimidating factor, and that might be a reason why. The reason why Vrabel doesn't have a job, I have no idea. And if there is a suit that is in the upper parts of a franchise who is making business decisions, and they're saying, this guy's a little too intimidating for us to add as a head coach of the National Football League, fire him immediately. Do not give him a severance package. He needs to pack his shit and he needs to go home. That is the most crazy, crazy take if somebody actually believes that someone's too intimidating to be a head coach. You want your guy. Now, Mike is a big ego guy. He's a big dude that when you have a conversation, it's on his terms. It's gonna be a deep conversation or a shallow conversation based on Mike. And you can love him or hate him for that, but the reality is he's a damn good head coach and he deserves to have a head coaching job, but it just seems like it's not in the cards this year.
I think Vrabel spends the next year.
Say that again.
How do you think Vrabel spends the next year?
Right now, I don't see the media portion. Maybe he does a couple hits here and there. I think Vrabel spends his season in Park City, Utah, smoking cigars and nicotine vapes and talking trash to the TV as he was watching Sunday Night Football, and all because he could go into media. He would do great in media, but I just don't see him taking a coordinator job or anything like that. There should be an appetite for Mike Vrabel come next Black Monday, whenever that happens, after week 18 of the NFL season next year.
Okay, we are going to, I think we have, do you see Will Levis? I guess he's not there in person. I think he's on Zoom. I think we're going to have Will Levis in a little bit. Control, what should we do? Sorry, I'm just trying. Oh, there. Hey, Will, here's me and Taylor Lewan. What's up?
Will Levis, baby, how are you?
I'm doing well. Doing well,
Taylor.
How are you?
You waking up this morning having a little coffee and a little mayonnaise and coffee, or what you up to, dude? What was your routine this morning?
No coffee this morning. Just pure vibes, you know. I don't need the caffeine.
I love it. I love it. No tan and pure vibes. Yeah. I love it.
Taylor, take it away. Ask Will a couple questions, and then we'll get you out of here. I just wanted you two to have a chance to talk, of course, because there's a lot of optimism around Will, and you've always had his back all season long on my show.
Yeah, Will, first off, big fan of you. Do you love the direction you're going to take the Tennessee Titans franchise in? Obviously, a new head coach. Have you had the opportunity to talk to Callahan? Have you had an opportunity to pick his brain? And how do you feel going into this next season?
I feel great. And I have had the opportunity to talk to him. And it was great for him to reach out to me pretty soon after he got the job and for him to express his excitement to work with me. And, you know, quickly got into the tape and, you know, watching what Cincinnati has been able to do and excitement for learning that offense. And obviously he's been able to work with some awesome quarterbacks. So hopefully, you know, be that next one for him. And I'm just ready to, you know, get boots on the ground and start working for him. But yes, I did get to meet him. I was there for his press conference when he first got here. Seems like a great dude. And I'm just excited.
I love it, dude. Very polished in the media world, man. I like it.
Will, what do you make? We're just talking about Vrabel. Our boy, we love Callahan, I'm a Cincinnati fan. Taylor's, you know, confused about why he doesn't have a job. What was your experience like with Vrabel, and why do you think he's not working as a head coach this year?
Yeah, I mean, I loved working for Coach, and it started our relationship, obviously, pretty specially growing up, you know, rooting for him and being a big fan of the Pats and having the opportunity to, you know, play for such a legend for the organization that I grew up a fan of was pretty cool. And, you know, He earns the respect from the players right away just because of, you know, his playing career. And, you know, it can get old, you know, sometimes when you say that he can say what he can say because he's been there, but he's 100% right. And that's a huge reason as to why guys love playing for him. And even though, you know, it didn't work out between him and the organization, you know, I love playing for him and I wish him the best going forward.
Will, is he intimidating?
I think he can be sometimes, especially, you know, as a rookie going in the NFL, any coach can be intimidating. But he definitely has got that alpha dog mentality that some people can't handle.
What's the maddest you ever saw?
maddest I ever saw him.
Taylor, I want your answer too.
At me, probably. I think he told me specifically not to throw it to somebody that I threw it to in the game, and that never goes over well. So that was against Houston, I think, that first Houston game, and I didn't want to look him in the eyes, that's for sure.
Taylor.
The most I've ever seen Vrabel mad was his first year in 2018. We were at a practice during camp. It's hot, it's brutal, and he's just chewing at guys over and over again. And I had a little juice at the time. I was playing well, obviously, and I started talking back to him. I was a coachable individual, but I was also a controversial individual when it came to coaches and authority. I never did well with that. So he and I got into it, and he's got a piece of chew on his lip, and he's screaming at me, ends up kicking me out of practice. And it was like, I don't know, maybe a week into training camp 2018. He's one of those guys that he'll yell at you, and then after that, he's going to call you in the office. He's going to have talk to you why you can or cannot do certain things. And there was one very big positive is I had the worst game of my entire life. It was week one of 2021 against Chandler Jones. I gave up two sacks. Will Levis would have been dead if he was quarterback. It was terrible. And he brings me in the office and he goes, hey, I want you to know we didn't lose that game because of you. Like, you obviously didn't play well, but he definitely like lifted me up in that situation in a time where confidence was wavering. I was coming back off the ACL. And so there's that yin and yang of Vrabel that he does such a phenomenal job of.
Taylor, we're going to let you go. It's funny, you look like you're like hosting a coffee talk show, like little Kelly. And yeah, you just spot there. You're on my set. I'm excited to get there. I don't know, Will, you're coming to town too. We're both descending upon Vegas. Be ready, Taylor, to make time for us to hang out with us. We love you. I'll find you. I will follow the empty canister of Zin throughout Vegas to find myself too, my favorite guy, Taylor Lewan. Guys, check out Bustin' with the Boys this week. I'm waiting for my invite onto the program.
Okay, you've got an invite. You know you're more than invited every single time. And Will, before I go off this show, I'm gonna need a verbal commitment from you. 2024, you coming on Bustin' with the Boys?
Confirmed.
Hey, you guys have a great day. We got some stuff done today. Have a phenomenal afternoon.
I feel really good. And like you're saying, I've had a coffee. I held the mayo on this one. I want to forget about that storyline entirely. I love getting to talk to you.